of February 8th. Start off with approval of the December 21 meeting summary. Do I hear a motion to approve as submitted?
So moved.
Motion. Is there a second? Discussion on the summary. Hearing none, call for the question. All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed.
Motion carries unanimously. We move on to the RTA next plan development update. Hockey. I know you handed out a new list or a list or some information. By the way, we did have some issue with the mics. Can everybody hear me at this point based on the mic?
Mike, I can hear you, but if Pocky just responded to your question, I couldn't hear her.
Is that better?
That's better. Thank you.
Okay. So before we dive into, or you dive in to discuss the project list, the name project, I just wanted to give you a really quick update on where we are with the RTA next plan activities. And that way, you know, you can start your discussion. But as after your January 11th meeting, the CAC did meet on January 23rd, and they did approve a recommended list of named projects, and that's what we'll be discussing today. And then that'll go for RTA board consideration later this month when they meet. At the last meeting on Monday, CAC started their categorical discussion. So just wanted to inform you of that the categorical discussion is now starting, and hopefully they'll wrap it up either the end of this month or next month. And then today, obviously, you'll be reviewing the recommended name project list and provide additional technical feedback. And then we don't have a date set yet for the board meeting, but it'll be either next week or the following week. And then on February 21st, which is a Tuesday, that'll be the last meeting of the CAC for this month. And again, hopefully wrap up the categorical. So that's the quick update on RTA next activities. So leading up to that, there is a handout that's been distributed.
I have a question. Next week, the transit subcommittee is meeting. What's their role in what you just described?
So yeah, thank you, Sam, for reminding me of that. The CAP has a transit element subcommittee that's going to begin meeting, and that's going to be to discuss the sub-elements of the transit element and go over the investment buckets and have the subcommittee consider, you know, whether what buckets to keep, whether the sub-elements are the appropriate ones to move on to the RTA next plan. The subcommittee met back in 2020, and then they had one more meeting last year just to confirm that these are probably the sub-elements that we'd be moving forward, but they just want the subcommittee members just want to make sure to confirm the costs and make sure that they're in line with what the RTA board budget that was given.
That's a subcommittee to the CAC?
It is a subcommittee to the CAC.
So they will report back to the CAC on
Correct.
The 21st?
Yes.
Hey, Bucky, you said that there was not a, that there's a meeting that's not been scheduled yet. I'm not sure. Was that the RTA board meeting or is that a different
board? The RTA board meeting will be meeting later this month, but I don't believe
we I think that's the 23rd of March.
Yeah, that hasn't been confirmed yet, but tentatively it'll be in March.
I just, that's the one you're talking about, though. The RTA, okay, that's fine. Thank you.
So what we're going to do next is Jeanette's going to pull up portal again, and this will be in line with this spreadsheet that you just received. Hopefully the members on remotely have received that by email. And
let's confirm that. Shane, did you get that spreadsheet that Pocky's referring to? And I see John and Curtis and Steve, and Carolyn Campbell. Did you all get that?
I want to help Crystal with that. She's working on it.
I did, Mike. Thanks for checking in. I did get the spreadsheet. yeah, thank you. I got it.
Okay, good. John and, well, the rest of you all that are online participating, do you all have the...
Hey, Mike.
Yep.
Good, if it was sent, if it was sent this morning, I haven't seen it.
She's working on it.
Okay. Sounds like the staff is working on that now. Why don't you let us know when that goes out so that we can. So we'll let you all know when that email goes out so that you all can be looking at it. In the meantime, we're gonna go ahead and go keep going and let Pocky keep moving through this. And then if there's a question after you get it, we can certainly come back and answer them. Go ahead, Pocky.
Okay, so again, the list before you is the name project list that the CAC recommended. There's approximately 37 projects on here. And what we're going to do is, well, first of all, they were ranked in the order of how the sponsor ranked them, just for your information, just so that you have an opportunity to see now where they're currently ranking. So what we're going to do is have Jeanette pull those up on the portal so that you can start going through each one of them and looking at the cost, you know, looking at the rank. Jeanette also has the ability to pull up the geographic map so that you can see as you move along where this these projects are located in the region. So with that, I think we can turn it over to Jeanette to
Yeah, we can go ahead and get started. So what you're seeing on the screen right now are the 37 projects that the CAC recommended to move forward. They're the same ones that are on your spreadsheet. The total RTA cost at the bottom, the $1.4 billion, that's the amount of money that's being requested for each of those projects in total. This does include the cost estimate revisions that the jurisdictions provided to us just recently. So you'll see some of those numbers have been updated since you may have seen them last. Right now, they're sorted by jurisdiction rank. And I've scrolled to the bottom of the screen so you can see the lower ranked projects. And we thought that might be a good place to start to talk about some of those projects and maybe they're an easy low-hanging fruit to start whittling that $1.4 billion price tag down. So that is kind of what our intent of the meeting today is to whittle that list down to meet that $1.1 billion fiscal constraint that the RTA board has asked us to meet.
I was going to say, if I may add a little bit more perspective to that, and I'm going to ask Mr. McGovern to chime in as well. So as you all recall at the last meeting, the CAC, I think, did their best to meet that $1.1 billion budget. And again, Mr. McGovern, I think, did a great job of trying to get them there. But I think they really need feedback from this group before they can get any further along. So anything that you can do to help them to kind of guide them in the right direction would be very helpful.
Do you want to add anything to that?
No, I'm just trying to play catch up here. I didn't know that there had been additional cost estimates provided. So I thought we were still at $1.1 billion recommended.
You could be a city manager, Tom. So why don't we do this? I do have some thoughts and comments, but I'll reserve mine for a little bit. Why don't I open it up to those that are online? I see we've got Steve, Shane, John, Carolyn, Bill, or Curtis. Anybody, any of you all have comments at this point?
Mike, can you hear me?
Yeah, go ahead, Curtis. Go ahead.
Yeah. I just have a general comment. The cost estimates so far do not include a local matching amount. On the RTA one, we had $2.1 billion of forecasted sales tax revenue, and an additional 0.4, or roughly 25%, was local matching funds. When we introduce local matching funds to this, it starts to make a difference on the need to chop projects. So I'm just generally one, and I think this subject of local match has come up before. And I also think it may be a statutory requirement to include it in the plan. So, you know, as we begin to whittle down these projects, how does the issue of local match fit into the overall picture? And I bring that up now before we start talking about chopping projects.
That's a great, great question. Do these cost estimates assume the total cost? Is that?
Yes. So what you have in front of you is the total amount requested from the RTA. Other than ADOT, no other sponsor offered any local match. We have asked and be happy to revise and add any local match if anybody is willing to bring any local match to those projects. But currently, ADOT projects are the only one that have local match added to them at obviously their request. No other project has local match on it.
Great. If I can just follow up with that, Mike and Farhad, to me, it's a little bit disappointing because the RTA's sales tax and the sales tax extension is a tremendous opportunity for leveraging funds and not just leveraging local money against federal and state money, but leveraging it against our own revenue sources here locally. Development impact fees, exactions, et cetera. So to me, I think we're missing the boat by so many projects attempting to move forward with a 100% RTA sales tax revenue. So I just throw that out there. I know it's more of a policy thing and we're starting to talk more about individual projects, but to me, the lack of a local funding element on this is disappointing. So thank you very much.
Thank you, Curtis. Shane, do you have a comment specifically on that?
I do. Thanks. you know, so I guess this is a bit showing my ignorance on the current program. So currently, are the RTA projects in this first initial round, do they all have a local match on them? Can I get an answer to that one?
Great question. Yeah, Mr. Chair, Shane, the current plan was obviously a similar exercise at the time back in 2005, and not all the projects are fully RTA funded. As part of that exercise, similar to what we're doing here today, hopefully, there was a conversation about which projects are priorities, and by making those projects whole, some of the entities brought impact fees to the table or other local match to the table to make sure that those projects are fully funded in the program. So it's really a similar exercise that we're talking about today, that if a project can be made whole, then can we bring other funds to the table? And if that's the case, we would identify that and subtract that from the RTA amount requested.
So it's not a component found in all of the projects as a standard. It's kind of a hybrid. If it needed to be made whole, then the local jurisdiction was looked to bring forward additional funds. Is that kind of how it's working today?
Correct. And again, as there are some of the folks that were back on the CAC and TMC back then, if they recall, it really became down at the 11th hour that if a project really was the project that we wanted to make sure that it stays in the plan, we were able to bring other funds to the table to make sure it stays in the plan. So it's the art part, right? So if we really need another couple million dollars for a project, let's see if we can add that to the plan.
Okay. So, I mean, it'll be interesting. I don't want to get the cart before the horse, but it would be interesting if this group really struggles in taking projects off the list to come to that magical $1.1 billion threshold. It'd be, I'd like to keep on the table the consideration of just taking the delta here that we're looking at and figuring out, okay, on each project to equalize the burden of covering the difference, what kind of local match would be required on all of these projects in order to make them happen, just for consideration as one option to get across the finish line. Thanks.
Thanks, Shane. Jeff?
And Shane, a little bit like you, this is a rookie question. We're also working to put a number within the bucket, right, of named projects. Is there any opportunity or ability to discuss or bring into any of these conversations the other buckets at this point?
That's a great question. Hang on, Farhad. So I think that's the commentary that I wanted to make. You didn't necessarily open the door, so thank you. Have a conversation around that. I think that the difficulty with this is we're doing it in a singular linear manner, and I think that at least on my end, we are struggling with, I'll use the term, worrying about what project gets in or doesn't get in, in that bucket or that pot. And I think the conversation needs to be broader than to include the investment of the entire program. And so I know that, Tom, your folks on the CAC, I should say your folks, the CAC have been struggling with that to some level in terms of, you know, some of the commentary that I've seen or heard in terms of how does this fit into the investment on a macro scale. I mentioned to you during the ad hoc conversation the struggle that I was expecting on Marianne Cleveland Way. Well, that certainly played out almost exactly like we scripted. And so it got me thinking about a conversation. So fortunately we didn't meet last week because that's really when all of this really came into my head anyway. How do we look at the investment of the entirety of the RTA Next with the entire region in mind? And then, as Jan said a year ago, overlay the jurisdictional boundaries, overlay the reward boundaries, overlay disenfranchised neighborhoods in the past, those kinds of things that can then help us with the tweaking. Because if we focus solely on the name project list, we're going to have a, I use the term fight, but we're going to have a conversation around that. And then we're going to have the same conversation on the other categorical pieces. Each time. And what I think it does is it divides the opportunity or it could be divisive in terms of how the region could come together on this. And so what I've suggested to the council, and so it's good that the board meeting has been delayed to May or to March, excuse me, because I've got three more council meetings between now and then. And what I've suggested to them is we're going to take the Move Tucson framework that was developed with the public, try to marry that up to as close as we can to the RTA framework. What I'm suspecting is going to happen is there'll be overlap, but it won't be the same. And so what I've suggested is let's look holistically at what the recommendation will be. Doesn't necessarily change the projects, but it could certainly change the number of projects when we factor that in. I will then bring a recommendation back on again, a more holistic approach to what those investments could look like and ultimately resonate with not only the mayor and council, but ultimately with the voters in Tucson. So it wasn't necessarily Marianne Cleveland Way that was the issue, but it really was gnawing at me as to, you know, what I was trying to do was put a round peg in a square hole. And so the discussion that I've been struggling with is what I'll call a piecemeal approach. And I think that at least from where I sit, so I don't have to worry about the one project, it's really the holistic approach to the investment. So that's what I'm working on, and I will bring that forth to our next meeting and present that. It is not my intent to muck up the works. It's really my intent to try to build the support necessary to ultimately move this forward. So,
Mr. Chairman, can I just do a quick check? I was looking at the agenda item to make sure that we're consistent with open meeting, because we've really done a little bit of a curve, and it says it's RTA plan development update. So I would ask staff, I just want to be sure that we haven't screwed up open meeting because I threw a wrench into it. So
thank you. I'll try to respond to your question, because I think your question hopefully moves the conversation forward. So really the exercise, as I understand it, was RTA board at the November meeting established these budgets for each element. $1.1 billion was the capacity for named projects that was established by the board. So going back to your question, I believe their intent is to have $1.1 billion worth of named projects. And then the other three elements obviously have a budget assigned to those as well. And those elements or those buckets, they're not named projects. They're a little bit more descriptive. So that's the intent of the board. That's the direction we have from the board. So to answer your question, we would like to have a list of $1.1 billion worth of projects moving forward to them. Going back to the conversation about local match, that local match is just icing on the top. We can add local match to the 1.1 as much as available. So we can have a list of $1.5 billion worth of projects, 1.1 RTA, 0.4 non-RTA. And I think that's, hopefully that answers your question.
I didn't hear an answer to the question on the open meeting law. I think that this is consistent.
Yeah, no, again, as long as we're talking about RTA plan development, we're fine.
And there's no lawyers in the room, we're good.
There's no lawyers.
Yeah.
All right, good.
Well, and I understand that, and I think what I started hearing about a year ago from Mayor Honey, and had great respect for, was let's start the conversation. At least the way I heard it, let's start looking at RTA next based on, my words again, the buckets as they existed before, and then see what happens. So I think that's been an absolute right way to do this. And so if we need to start, but I also think then if this group wanted to ever make a recommendation back to the board, right, that maybe we've made some adjustments and we'd like to make any changes potentially in the realignment of any of those buckets, we possibly could do that as a separate recommendation.
Correct. So again, the action of the board, I believe, at least the intent and hopefully the outcome was that here are the parameters, work within these parameters. And if you want to make any recommendations, great, bring your recommendations back. But those parameters are really critical to get us to that July deadline, right?
But the
right.
other half a billion that we need for the county, I could put in that.
Local funds are always welcome. Okay, I'll put it down here for you.
John, I see your hand up, go ahead. You might be muted, John. We can't hear you.
Yep.
I'm sorry. Here, I'm.
There you go. There you go.
Yeah, thanks, Mike. I heard you mention about coming back to this group with the Move Tucson emphasis that the city of Tucson has. Maybe I'm speaking for Mr. McGovern on this one. I'm just wondering, has the city compared your Move Tucson document to whatever the CAC guiding principles are? I think that might help us if there's any real disconnects there.
Yeah, John, thanks. Yes, and I think there's a lot of consistency there. I don't think that it will be inconsistent with the guidelines. What I'm really seeing, John, quite frankly, is the linear approach is causing me grief in terms of how I have conversation about one piece without the rest of the pieces. And I think that's part of the conversation that I've heard from the CAC. And it hit me like a ton of bricks last week when I was having a conversation around investment of the RTA plan as a whole. And so what I'm really trying to do is bring all of it, at least in a way that will resonate with the council and get support for where that investment and how that investment looks. So I don't think it's inconsistent. It is a little different view, but I think we get to the same place or very similar place. What I think will probably end up happening based on my preliminary view is the named project list for a city of Tucson, maybe less than other categorical elements. That's my gut at this point. I don't know that for sure, but that's basically where I think we might land.
Okay, thank you, Mike.
Let me just, Sam, did you want to add anything to that? Yeah. Sam's doing all the work, so that's good. Go ahead, Tom.
Yeah, I think this points out, you know, one of the concerns, I guess, and also frustrations of some members of the CAC, and frankly, every member of the CAC recognizes that it's not a plan until all the categoricals and name projects are put together. And in fact, some of our goals can't be fully checked. We can't see whether we're meeting those goals, such as congestion, equity, some others, until we have an entire plan together. So while it's frustrating, we do have to be patient. I think it was more than appropriate for us to focus on these named projects. They're the biggest part of the plan and probably required the most amount of brain power, brain damage, whichever you want to call it. And And we are, you know, launching into the next most important, probably, which is the transit and the rest of these categoricals. But frankly, can't say that it's a great plan yet because it isn't. It's just a list of named projects. So we're also anxious to be able to get to the point where we can say, here's what the whole thing looks like. Let's show that to the public, or let's pass that forward to the board, and you know, get this feedback loop going. It's an iterative process, but as you pointed out, currently it's somewhat linear.
Yeah, and I think, Tom, the points are what I've understood from some of the frustration, and where it's been difficult is in saying, well, don't worry, we're going to get to that investment down the road, without seeing all of it together. That's really the struggle, I think. And
yeah, there are a number of project types which can fit in multiple categories. They could be a name project. They could probably be a safety project. You know, some of them even, you know, go into the transit side, and then there are elements, sub-elements, which could be in multiple categories as well. Many of which are mostly being, or much of the satisfaction of those sub-element goals is occurring in the named projects, you know, pedestrian and signals and bike lanes and all that are an integral part of the named project. So we have to be able to look at the whole thing together. I agree with that.
So we will continue to work on it. I'm just kind of letting you all know where I'm headed and where we're going. We will continue to work on that. And then as time, hopefully within the next couple of weeks, I'll be able to share that and give to you all. And you all can see at least what our thoughts are to bring it all together, at least on from our perspective. Go ahead, Tom.
Just last comment. I'd appreciate that if all the jurisdictions could take a look at it the same way. We don't know, and we'll never, we won't know before an election what the projects will be within any of these categorical sub-elements, because the whole idea is that we need this to be a 20-year plan. Many of the projects that'll be needed won't be known for another 10 or 15 years. So we'll go in knowing some of the projects we need today, but we're not going to go in knowing and being able to name, you know, all these sub-element projects. And so it's important for us to understand, where do you stand now? What kinds of projects and specific projects would you see at the beginning that you need right now in those sub-elements? And then show us how you're projecting what you're going to need over the next 20 years in that same vein.
Here is a reality, right? I mean, we're pretty far down the path, and it's not necessarily a change, but it's definitely, let's organize ourselves around those other components as well and bring those into the discussion, which I think, you know, just based on the initial dollar amounts would seem to be less, but I think they could be more impactful from a voter perspective. And so my goal is to ultimately get support for the plan from the Tucson Mayor Council, and I think I'm going to need to do that in a holistic manner in order to be able to do that. Go ahead, Sam.
Thanks, Mr. Chair. If I could just respond quickly to Mr. McGovern. In our Move Tucson plan, we did take a look at that 20-year horizon. We identified projects, named projects, that we believe the City of Tucson needs, but to your point, we also identified categories of projects such as greenways, where we don't exactly have the alignment or this project scope lined out, but we know that we need to assign some money, some investment to those types of projects. And I expect that we'll see a level of that in what we bring forward. So,
Brad,
I think you had a question, right?
No. Yeah, go ahead. So part of what I'm hearing, though, too, is that we reserve some rights to step back at some point, right? That if this list comes out and all the names are there, and then we look at some of the other, we've talked about it, and I'll just say, it's like how we look at what's lining up and what jurisdictions are getting. And then if we come back and there's a huge ask from another jurisdiction on a light rail or something, then we may want to go back and readjust some, or recommend that the board readjust the other.
I think it has to be fluid based on whatever's going on. Jan, that's my question. When is the next TMC meeting scheduled?
Wednesday, second Wednesday of the month at 9 a.m.
So that'd be March
8th. Okay. So if I may just want to go back and remind everybody. So ultimately, $2.3 billion is the projected revenue that's approved by the board. Within $2.3 billion, the board identified $1.1 billion of named projects. And those named projects came through the submittals from all jurisdictions. So the projects that are now on this list came from all the jurisdictions that have, through their own planning process, identified what their priorities are. So my understanding is, and I think that goes back to what Mr. McGovern said, confirm that those projects are still your priorities, confirm that those projects are the ones that you want to include in the plan. And in addition to that, confirm if there's additional local funds that can come to the table so we can put those pieces together. I think we're in a good place right now with the list you have in front of you, and that's really the exercise for today. Is there anything on this list that's not consistent with your plan? Is there anything on this list that you believe is not a high priority? And that's hopefully the conversation we can have today to provide feedback back to the CAC. Otherwise, they're not going to be able to move along without having that feedback. So anyone is happy with what they see on here, we like to hear that as well.
Mr. Chairman. Jerry and then Tom. Go ahead, Jerry.
Yeah, so by way of feedback and direct response to exactly what Farhad is asking for feedback for the CAC, I think from Miranda's standpoint, the three projects that are listed would be our priorities. We want to maintain those. With regard to any match that might be available, now we have a council retreat that's coming up actually the week after our next TMC meeting. So it'll be a little bit late and we won't be able to have probably the feedback with regard to any match. But I do think that's an important element. And I do know that the council is willing to talk about that because these projects are very important to our community. So I wouldn't be able to say at this point what that might look like, but I can say without reservation that those three projects listed on this list right now would be projects that the town would want to go forward.
Hey Terry, when you're thinking local match, and this is actually for everybody, and I wasn't involved in the 05, 06 discussion. Are you thinking that the conversation would be impact fees or some future, I'll use the term other source like general fund or other? I'm just curious. I'm not trying to put you on the spot because I'm thinking about that as well. You know, we should all step up and say, hey, what does that look like from a local investment standpoint? I'm just curious.
Yeah, so we've had some preliminary discussions on where we would pull that money from. And at this point, I don't think we have any solid answers to that. I think it would probably be a combination of funding sources. So at this point, I would say that still in the works. We hope to make some recommendations to our council at the retreat. To be able to say, hey, here's how we think that we can provide some contribution to these projects, because we recognize there's a delta here and there's going to have to be some ground to be made of. So,
okay. All right. Thanks. Go ahead, Tom.
Yeah, I just wanted to point out that a couple of new projects have been proposed to the CAC, and we didn't take any action on those except to discuss them and try to learn about them, but rather sent them to you, to this group, to vet and make recommendations to us about them. One is a country club, I-10 up to TIA, and the other is a proposal for kind of a new route in the Bale area, Camino La Malta. So those two projects would be ones that we would like to get some feedback from you on, at some point. Certainly once we go back into talking about these after the board reacts and after you react about the main project list and we take it up again, that's information that we also want to factor in.
Are those two projects on the list?
So, Mr. Chair, only one of them was approved by the CAC. The other one was not part of their motion. So only one is included.
The country club. The one that's on the screen there?
Yep.
And what was the other one?
Camino Loma Alta. Was an extension from...
Is that county?
That was not approved by the CAC.
So. But Tom asked for...
Well, yeah, it wasn't... It wasn't acted on by the CAC.
Certainly. But there was because interest in getting feedback on it.
Yeah.
Whose project was that, yours? Is that a county project?
I'm going to respond to our county projects.
So actually, if you don't mind, let me go back to my question and maybe Carmine can kind of include that in his comment. So again, as you all know, as part of the feedback, the CAC added the one project that the county requested. And Thorndale was added as well. So hopefully the project list is more balanced now. And then as Tom said, there was a request to add another project in lieu of a Colossal Cave. And we can have that discussion with you, but the CAC did not approve that.
Okay, but again, I'm focusing on what Tom asked, which is feedback on those.
I'm asking Carmine.
Yeah. So yeah, but you're saying the CAC approved and I'm like, well, let's let Carmine get on it.
Yeah.
Thank you, Chair. So from the county standpoint, the list is reflective of the input we gave and the asks that we made at the last meeting. So we're generally happy with the listed projects that are included in there. So the discussion about Camino Loma Alta, and as the conversation was going on, I was scanning our original request and I don't see that. So it sounds, Tom, that this is a newly made request. And can you clarify by whom?
Yes. So we had a citizen member who submitted a proposal the day of, and it was discussed during the meeting, and the CAC did not act on that item. But yes, we did say we'll coordinate with the county and provide feedback.
So we're happy to go back, take a look at that relative to all the other projects. So we don't have input for you.
But the proposal was in lieu of Colossal Cave.
Okay. So I think
feedback.
Yeah, we're not prepared to give any recommendation on it.
I think somebody just did.
I just haven't seen it. So that's the only reason for my hesitation. But I think the point made by Mr. Ortega about taking a holistic look at not only the roadway element, but the other categorical elements is important, and you know, to get to a plan that is supportable by the region, by the voters, I think that's an important element of it. So I just want to echo those comments and think that it's important now that that conversation be brought along to match up with where we are in this. And maybe this is parked, right? We put a pin in this for right now, other than right, going back and asking the jurisdictions to take a look at what type of contributions they can make to it. From our perspective, I'm sure from everyone's, we would be looking primarily at impact fees, and forecasting those out over the period of time we're talking about is a little bit of a challenge. I heard someone say it's an art, right? And we need to take a look at that, and certainly are prepared to come back at a future point and give greater input on that. Along those same lines, the three ADOT projects that are on the list, those are at the full project dollar amount. So those also then potentially get reduced, or have these been reduced?
I believe these have been reduced. These look like they're 50%.
Okay. No, actually, they have not. These are the requested amount with, I'm sorry, let me clarify. This is the requested amount with whatever you submitted initially. So that's still the initial submittal, right?
It's the RTA funding request column on those. There's the three projects right there. It's the total, 210.
Is that the total cost though?
No. It is the requested amount from the RTA. What is the split? Is it 50? We don't know, right?
Right. It's roughly 50.
Right. Okay.
It's roughly 50.
I misasked that.
That's not the full cost of the project. It's about 50%.
And so, is that where we believe those numbers need to be, or is there a potential downward adjustment to that?
You asking me? No, I believe. Yeah, I think it's a discussion that we should have, and I do think there is opportunity for potential reduction in that. It all depends on what the region wants. and how they want to pursue, with the goal of, is this something that you want to lock in as a project, as three projects that are going to happen within the period, which is one of the main purposes of it, of doing that, is to lock that those projects in so they won't get changed by future boards. They're now part of the program, the voters approved them, and they'll move forward. What percentage of that is really up to this body and then the PAG board in terms of what percentage would make that lock in. In our minds, ADOT's minds, anywhere, we were thinking anywhere from 50% to 20% would be a reasonable term. But there's other areas and other communities, jurisdictions that have other needs within the ADOT right-of-way. And that hasn't necessarily been spelled out. So we need to have that open discussion as well as to how much is going to be, ADOT's going to participate, I guess, in those projects that we didn't put on our list, but another jurisdiction did put that are in our right-of-way. We're perfectly willing to participate in those, but at what rate? So
let me make sure I'm clear. Those don't look like 50%. What am I missing? Those look like they're more than 50%.
Well, if you look, it's DCR. I'm looking at the DCR. And
I'm looking at total cost column against RTA funding request, and those don't look like 50% to me. My math's a little fuzzy, but those don't look like that. I'm not trying to beat you up. I'm just saying, is it linear to say it's 50%, it's 20%? We just take the total cost multiplied times 0.2, and that's our number.
Right. With only having the numbers in front of me out of the DCR. So, for example, we'll look at which project here. I'll look at the one that's the lowest.
Hey, Rod, while you're looking that up, and maybe Farhad or someone else has been around for a bit, what was the contribution from the RTA to the ADOT projects in the 06 plan?
Yeah, so if we recall at the last TMC meeting, we had a spreadsheet. It varied. It went anywhere from 15% to 30%. I think the average was in that 25 to 30% range.
So when you say on ADOT type projects, so you're talking about like
INA traffic interchange, Twin Peaks traffic interchange. Yes, there was a frontage road down in Green Valley. So the split at the time was about, I wouldn't say the average was about 30%.
We had projects from, we had INA, overpass, we have Hoover off overpass, we've got line one. Currently, Irvington is also has RTA money in it, and that's all been about what I call about 20%, 25%.
So then, when we start talking about matching, so you can get, you know, Miranda's got two projects here that are affect, you know, ADOT with interchanges. So if the town comes with a match, you're saying ADOT is coming with a match on that as well?
No, I think it's the opposite. I think if I'm understanding it, it's an ADOT project, then the RTA would provide the match.
Yeah, but I just heard Rod say that if there are projects that are in other jurisdictions, that other jurisdictions put on that are in their right of way,
that they
would be willing to come to the table.
I think outside of the RTA.
That's outside of the RTA. So the way it happened, the PAG region programs all of ADOT funding within the PAG region. It doesn't get programmed by the ADOT board. It gets programmed by the PAG board in the PAG region. So if the RTA has money with ADOT, RTA or ADOT considers the RTA local funds. So we want to make that clear. If you're talking to an ADOT person and you say local funds, they're going to think RTA. When you're talking to an RTA person and they say local funds, they're going to think about the jurisdiction. So you got to make sure you have that clarification. So when you go to when PAG board or programs a project, puts a project, say in the RTA next, we put a project that now is secured by voters. If there's only 20% of the cost of that project secured by the voters, the PAG board will then assign the remaining ADOT funds to that project. Otherwise, they'll lose that 20% that they've already committed. You understand what I'm saying? Am I saying that clear, Farhad?
Yeah, and again, so this is where it gets a little bit complicated. So obviously regional council has a role in this discussion as well. So when the time comes, we can bring a draft plan with potential proposed splits, take it through the regional council process, and then identify if there's additional ADOT allocated funds to the region that can be assigned to RTA projects. So it just kind of makes it a little bit more complicated, but the process is the same. Let's use a project, the first project, first phase, currently shown about $74 million request from the RTA. Using the 50% split, that means ADOT brings another $74 million to the project. Now, is all that $74 million purely ADOT money, or is there some local match? That's a conversation we need to have to make that project full. And we have time for that. So the question really becomes, let's identify the delta. What is the true delta? And then let's start chewing away at that delta.
You also have to keep another aspect in mind. The pot, the ADOT funding pot is only so big. So we have a list of 15 or 20 projects that we're gonna have to march down I-19, we're gonna have to march down I-10. We've got a bunch of other projects in the region that all get funded from that one source. So we have to keep that funding source available for that stuff as well. That's why I mentioned at some point we should probably consider how much maximum we should spend a year out of that so we can keep the other projects that are also important to the region and they're going to be all done here in the region moving forward.
So I think Rod, that's exactly where we should be headed and looking at this. So if you look at that column and you add up the total cost column, and then take a number, 20%, 30%, 50%, whatever that number is what needs to be in the RTA plan. But the other piece that's left comes from the regionally allocated funds that the PAG board needs to then make a decision on. So the conversation is there enough money in the regional allocation, or at what point will there be enough money to make that happen? So it's almost like we're getting these two pots. We have this pot of RTA dollars, and then we have the state allocated funds for PAG, and those two pots go to making this up. And what the chemistry of that is a function of what we make in terms of recommendation to the RTA board. So it would make sense to me that we, I think we need to challenge whether or not the PAG region can fund the rest of that. Because when we say it's ADOT funds, they're ADOT, but if I'm understanding what Rod just said, they're ADOT, they come from ADOT, but they're distributed based on whatever the PAG council says.
So just to piggyback on what Rod said. So the answer is yes, there is plenty of ADOT allocated funds to the region over the 20-year life of the project. So that's the exercise that we need to do. We need to make a proposal to the regional council, and the regional council would say, yeah, these four or five projects are eligible. We can set aside those PAG allocated funds for these projects, and then we plug it into the RTA plan. So there is capacity, there is fiscal constraint over 20 years, but it's a prioritizing project, kind of a discussion we need to have. So in reality, this is the conversation. If the recommendation comes through this process that these five ADOT projects are a priority, then we take it to the regional council for that conversation.
Quick comment.
In getting to that point of being able to make a recommendation, this body seeing right the ability then to bring those regional funds, those PAG regional funds, to make these projects whole is necessary, right? We have to see that before we can make a recommendation. And then that has effect on what the total dollar amount of this list looks like. If these amounts go down to 30% instead of that 50, because the PAG region can provide the difference, then we've come closer to that 1.1 that we're striving to achieve. And then the regional jurisdictions, right, going back and saying, here's what we believe we can contribute to the projects. Does that get us where we need to be?
So I'm going to hold on, Farhad. I'm going to take it a step further. If we see the ADOT regional allocation, it could be that we say the match should be zero. If there's enough money from this pot to do the region, and the PAG council says, hey, we want to do these projects, And again, it's one big pot. I could see a scenario where we could say to them, hey, take those dollars out of the allocation that comes to the region. It's a conscious decision, which would then reduce or even eliminate, or could eliminate the RTA component to that. See, because I had misunderstood that, and I apologize. What I thought was that the RTA match would get us brownie points to get to help accomplish that, but also say, hey, you know what? We're putting local skin in the game, right? Well, if it's our money anyway, as a region, then it's really a conversation about how best to fund them if we agree that those are a priority. So that, based on this information, I think we may want to rethink that. Go ahead, Farhad.
Just to clarify it, RTA match, as Rod said, guarantees that the project will get prioritized for the life of the RTA. If it's not in the RTA plan, then it's outside of that process and it can go anywhere else at that point.
And that was the point I was trying to make. A future board, if the RTA next is a 20-year plan, a future board in 5, 10, 15 years could decide that that project's not as important anymore and not move it forward. Whereas if it's in the RTA next, it's going to have the funding in there.
So I think the key though is we're talking about the same thing, but if it's that important, then we do put in a match, but the match now doesn't have to be more than 10%, basically, just to solidify that it's in the plan and that this current board is taking to the voter an expectation that will, in essence, establish that as a priority going forward. That's all. So I'm just looking for ways to solve the nugget, right? You know, the shortfall. Go ahead, Rod and then Chris.
That's a reasonable perception. There's also another aspect of it that we might want to consider, which is that the projects that are laid out and the costs that are laid out are per the DCR that was done by ADOT. So if there is a need for things beyond the DCR, that's going to require local funding, which could be RTA next. So if, for example, we've got three projects on SR 210, there are no pedestrian cross. I'm just using this and pulling this out of the air as a theoretical discussion. There are no pedestrian crossings, bridge structures for pedestrians to cross SR 210 in the design concept before. If for some reason the city or the community decides that they want that, that would not be able to come out of ADOT funding because it was not in the DCR. It would have to be funded through a local funding process, which could be the RTA next funding.
Appreciate that. Go ahead, Chris.
I just... would like to get a little bit more information in regards to the PAG pot. So what would be the unintended consequences of pulling funds out of that to supplement some of these RTA projects?
Basically, everything else would suffer, I mean, if you will, because if we put all of these dollars towards that, then everything else that would or could be funded there could fall out. Don't say it. Go ahead, Rod. And then Rod.
So I would like to clarify a little bit that point. So the PAG regional funding that ADOT spends is strictly to be spent on ADOT projects and ADOT right of way. So it would not rob the communities of any of the projects. It would only offset where ADOT could spend its money. So if, for example, you put 20% on each of these three projects, that 20% of money would be spent on other ADOT projects within the region. Not, it wouldn't come out of local.
And just to add to that, and Chris, for your information. So currently what we do on an annual basis, we sit down with ADOT, look at their five-year plan and prioritize what needs to go in the five-year plan. And that's typically a coordination with the regional council and the state transportation board. So that will continue to happen. The only thing that's different in this case would be that if you have five projects that are eligible for those ADOT funds are already committed. And based on fiscal constraint, typically I would say we have ample capacity to commit funds for these projects. Now, if you were talking about billions of dollars, that's a different issue. But in the range that we're looking at, we have capacity to do that.
Other thoughts or comments? Good discussion. Thank you. I think that's really helpful.
along those lines, if you don't mind.
We've got some folks, Bob and then Carmine.
I'm sorry, before you go that, so I still want to hear from Sarita and Oro Valley on the list as well, but go ahead.
Okay, well, we'll get to them in a minute, but we've got some folks that have their hands up. Go ahead.
Okay, Bob. Mr. Chair, yeah, it's to touch base on Tom's request regarding some feedback on a couple projects. I mean, being from the private sector, looking at this list and where we want to make some hard choices to reduce this number down. Okay, there's two projects I look at. One was the Country Club corridor, and the other was the 36th Street project that had a number of, what, $67 million? Those two projects alone is over $115 million. So if our responsibility is to look at it from a regional standpoint and also to have some sensitivity to the voter support, those two projects, I'm saying these are going to be hard to justify. So if we want to look at two projects that you want to say, really, what's the logic in them? If we're trying to reduce the numbers, those two are the ones that pop out to me.
Thanks, Bob. Let's go to Carmine.
I think to Chris's request to see the pots of funding available, I don't think we can give good direction back to the CAC without seeing those dollars that are eligible to be applied to the ADOT projects and then have a discussion and maybe even get a recommendation from staff, right, RTA staff, in terms of how those dollars might help us reduce this number down closer to the 1.1. And that's it. We can then have conversation around it. But if we don't see those in numeric terms on all the different pots and where they're eligible to be applied to ADOT projects, we're going to come back and have the same conversation again and not make any decisions.
So it's a great point. I think it would be helpful to get what that looks like. And Farhad, you mentioned the five-year horizon is what you all do with ADOT. I would suggest that it needs to mirror RTA and look at a 20-year horizon, at least for plan and review purposes. I think there would be value there to then see where these fall into that. Because I don't have a sense for the magnitude of those dollars. And if we were to say, yes, the ADOT projects are where we want to put our emphasis, does that soak up all the money? Is there some left? I mean, going back to Chris's point about, you know, what impact it has to the rest of the region, and I understand it's on the main line or on the within the right of way, but I think that would be helpful is my gut. So
yeah, no, again, I agree. We have capacity. We can give you the actual numbers off the top of your head. What's your guess annual?
I don't have that off
the top of my head.
So what we are doing is because the overall project, the corridor study that these three projects that are in this list are located in is considered a major project by the feds. So we're required to do a financial plan on how to implement that entire project, so all 18 of them. And we're working on that right now. So part of that is to look at the funding aspects over the whole length and see what the feasibility is for it. So we've got a pretty good... We started in the first 5 years of the TIP. We've already got a couple of projects programmed and such. We'll be seeing that moving forward in the next few meetings. We have our consultant on board moving forward right now, developing that financial plan. And when I get that data, my plan was to make it available, work with PAG, and then make it available to this body and whoever needed it so that we could use it as a decision-making tool.
So I think for the next time we get together, it sounds like the 8th of March, if you could have the package of what the PAG allocation?
Yep.
Regional allocation?
The ADOT projects.
Right. Yes. What is the?
No, not the ADOT project. I'm talking about the funding. The funding that you project for.
Allocated to ADOT projects.
Yeah.
Okay. I'm just saying.
What is it?
STBG
funds, but allocated to ADOT projects.
Right. To give us an understanding of the whole pot over the next 20 years and how these projects might fit into that. I think that's important. So,
but I think that's what Ron is talking about. Their financial plan, their 20-year plan, we don't have. They're working on it.
Okay, but do you know what the annual allocation is? You multiply it times 20
that's,
and
that's
you come
what
back.
They're
yes,
provide
but also
us.
PAC should have that as well.
I agree.
So we do it within the 5 years. We do our 5-year program. One of the challenges we're going to see is that it drops after 5 years. Once the IJAA ends, the funding is going to go back down.
Well, that'd be sort of important to know. but I guess my concern is you keep saying projects, and projects assumes that we throw out some project to be done or accomplished. And what I'm saying is we need to know what the pot is so then we can say how many projects to put into that, because the chemistry of the local match will change or could change based on what that revenue stream looks like going forward. And I think it'll be important to get a holistic view of that.
Yeah, I agree. All I'm saying is I want to make sure everybody understands that ADOT projects federal funds coming to the state, and then the allocation that comes to PAC, all of that comes through the ADOT process. So we're working with them to get that information.
Curtis, I see your hand, then I'll come back to Farhad.
Oh, yeah. Thanks, Mike. I almost forgot what I was going to say, but it came back. Frankly, Mike, I don't know what more we can do today to this particular list. In the light of the discussion that we just had, and I look at the difference between the 1.4 and the 1.1 target on this, I think all the projects are doable at this point. With the refinements that we were talking about, you know, looking at the infusion of regional funds to help ADOT projects, as Terry and Shane mentioned, looking at their local matches and so on. So really, I guess my question is, what do we want to do with this list that's on the spreadsheet today? Frankly, I don't think we need to do anything because there's so many balls in the air right now. So I just throw that out for discussion.
Thanks, Curtis. I know that Farhad had mentioned possible feedback from Chris and Shane. I don't see Shane on anymore. He may have. Oh no, he's still there. Hey, Shane. So I don't know if you're able to provide some feedback. I know that Terry did earlier, and I'll get mine here in a minute. But Chris, did you have anything to?
I think we're happy to look at, you know, our own funding mechanisms. I agree would likely be impact fees. I don't know how big of a number that will be or how much that would actually move the needle. But I know we had projects in the past. We use it more to supplement the overages on projects that were under construction at the time, like LaToya. So we would have to look at that, but we're happy to do that. So.
Thanks, Chris. What about you, Shane?
Thanks, Mike. As we've looked at the two projects for Sabarita, I think we're pretty content. We recognize this is a regional effort. You know, it's our number one priority and our number four priority. But we, you know, we're team players in this, and we think that's a fair proportion, and we're ready to move forward.
Okay, very good. Farhad, you got
it. I was going to ask Chris the same thing. So I believe the two projects are still priorities for Oro Valley, correct?
Yeah, and I think the sponsor ranks on here, once we did our exercise at TMC early on, they really became our one and two, so we're good with this.
So one of the things that, and I'll just take a quick minute with the local funding, and I think I had not thought about this, but we should look at that. And I haven't looked at it very closely, to be honest with you. My gut is that we should designate impact fees, future impact fees. I will also just caution you, I got beat over the head on a project down the road here because I had collected enough and I'm on the hook for it because I said I would. And, you know, then all of a sudden we end up in a bad spot. But I do think that for planning purposes and for this discussion, there's value in at least running out some scenarios. And I think to your point, Terry, you're exactly right. I mean, it's hard to tell exactly what that's going to look like. So then it rises to a conversation around what sources we might be able to scrounge and scrape to help out. But Chris brings up an excellent point, which is a lot of times those dollars are needed for pedestrian crossing or whatever other overages might be a function of those projects at that time. And that's, I think, where we need to be really careful, not to be so conservative that it deep sixes the plan, but certainly we got to be cautious of that. So my suggestion would be for the next time to really bring forth whatever ideas you have that on the local, we'll call it the local, the jurisdictional funding, because local, I think it's confusing with the ADOT terminology, but if we look at the jurisdictional contributions that might be out there, and I'm not even sure how to do it other than to sit down with the planners and say, all right, what are we looking at for development in terms of potential impact fees and or earth allocation or general fund? I mean, there's not a lot of other options. Now, clearly, one opportunity for us as a region are federal funds, and we can certainly talk through that. But, you know, putting that in a plan that assumes some future allocation of a federal allocation, I think is really dangerous. So, go ahead, Shane.
Thank you, Mike. As the conversation has ensued, I just took liberty of, and I could be way off on this. I'm not really the spreadsheet guru, but you know, I think if we just took the delta and we spread it across all of the 37 projects based off of that delta and the percentage of the project on the total, I think what we're looking at it, unless we're able to reduce the delta something, I mean, we're looking at like a 24, almost 25% cost share on all of the projects just across the board. Each jurisdiction would have that 24-25% of the project. So I thought I'd just put that on the table for everybody to kind of digest as we go through that exercise. Thanks. Oh, I did have one more, Mike. I mean, is the idea of increasing the tax at all off the table, or is that still something that the board of directors has contemplated if we get into a situation? I mean, we got to do our due diligence, but at the end of the day, if we can't quite hit that $1.1 billion threshold, what kind of flexibility has the board given themselves to entertain? Do we increase that allocation for these projects and decrease allocation somewhere else, or do we consider potentially a higher tax rate? Thanks.
Is that in the form of a motion?
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Shane, the board has been having that discussion for years now, and obviously there is a cap of 1%. So there is that option. Obviously, that's the governing board's prerogative to have that conversation and to elect to go beyond the current 0.5 cent. We've been having that conversation off and on for several years. At this point, based on the direction we've received, they are only focusing on maintaining the current 0.5 cent at $2.3 billion. And that was a direction that was given to us back in November. But again, obviously the option is there. And as the governing board, they have that prerogative to exercise going beyond the 0.5 cent. And we'll just have to stay tuned and see what happens.
Well, I appreciate that answer, Mr. Chair. I think it's important that we can't just expect the board to seriously entertain a thought like that without some kind of feedback or input from this committee. They're not really feeling the pain of the exercise yet because it hasn't hit them. But at some point, given our best efforts, if we can't hit that 1.1 for good, solid rationale reasons, we have to help them in considering those types of options. We have a role to play, in other words, in that dialogue at some point in time. Thanks.
That's a good thought, Shane. Thanks. Something's been gnawing at me. Terry, you mentioned that your projects, and if I looked at them, it's the Cortero Road TI. I don't know what the scope of that is, but is that in the ADOT right away?
Yes, the whole thing's ADOT.
And then the other one is the Tangerine. Given the conversation we had earlier about the PAG allocation, does it make sense for us to put those projects on that side of the ledger and reduce these numbers to the local match, to the RTA match? I'm just kind of thinking how to get to the promised land, right? And although that took 40 years, I'd rather not take 40 years. I'm just kind of thinking out loud that maybe there's a way that we can put those regional dollars into the mix to try to get you your projects that are high priority, but reduce the RTA component of that to a lesser number. And so those numbers, that 90 million, you know, goes to, you know, some percentage of that. I mean, does that make sense?
Mr. Chair, I'd like some clarity. So are you asking, say the project is 90 million. Are you asking for the RTA to contribute the RTA and the local jurisdiction to contribute 50% of it?
No.
And then ADOT to contribute out of PAG ADOT regional funds the other 50%? Is that the question?
No, I'm not suggesting anything other than looking at, again, holistically. We have the PAG. So you call them ADOT money, I call them PAG money now that you clarified that.
Okay.
So the dollars that are allocated to the PAG region, we do that plan. You know, we look at that 20-year horizon. Marana has brought up two projects that are within the ADOT right-of-way or portions of them. I don't know the exact scope. Does it make sense for us to treat those projects the same as the other three projects that are on SR210 and throw those into the mix for funding out of that PAG, mostly, or the majority of the funding to come from that PAG allocation? And then the local match is the RTA responsibility to ultimately get them constructed. I'm just kind of thinking that through. I mean, that's the conversation, I think, going back to Carmine's point of the holistic picture of that. Go ahead, Rob.
It's a valid point. A valid point. What is the purpose and need for that project? That would be my first question. And, you know, we've had this conversation in the past. So the I-10 operates well in that area. There is plenty of storage.
That's not correct, Brad.
Okay. That's just like, what? That's fine.
What?
Maybe it's not a discussion for this.
Yeah. I think it is, though. But I don't know if you think I'm crazy. Just tell me. That'd be a normal day for me. But I'm just kind of thinking, how do we get those projects done using all of the regional money and RTA? And then it takes some of the pressure off the RTA. That's all I'm saying. And, you know, if we can justify using the PAG allocation for these projects, then we should consider doing that to ultimately get those projects done. That's all I'm saying.
So I think we have to look at it regionally, because that's not the only project. Those might be the only projects on this list, but they're not the only projects in the region. We still have the ADOT has a plan to march down I-19, widen I-19, we have to put PIs down there. We have to finish that section of I-10 all the way down, that older section of I-10 that we have to finish. There's a lot of areas that are not included in here that we still are planning on funding. So we want to make sure that we can continue marching down that road regionally. And if it's possible, and we can do that project as well at some percentage or even all of it, that's fine. But I think regionally, we have to keep in mind the entire interstate system and the entire state highway system needs to use that funding to upgrade and be maintained.
So does the PAG Regional Council have a decision on that or not?
They do. They decide the regional funding, yes.
What am I missing? Go ahead, Tom.
Yeah, maybe what we're missing is whether these TIs are a part of the ADOT board's priorities.
But it's not the ADOT board to make that.
Do they show up on ADOT's radar at this point?
So PAG programs, PAG board programs the ADOT funding in the region. The ADOT board moves that into the program. That's it.
So it's not the ADOT. That's my whole point, though. It's not the ADOT board. And I think the more holistic conversation, Tom, is what is the region? And it goes back to Chris's point, right? I mean, if we increase the dollars for these projects, what else suffers? And I think that's an important piece, which goes back to your point, Rod, that, you know, you've got an idea, you've got plans for certain improvements. So then that is part of this discussion, right? The dollars are finite, whether they're RTA or they're the PAG allocation.
Right? Correct.
I'm just thinking that that might be a conversation, and maybe it would be better to see the plan, you know, see what that projected plan is, both on the revenue and expense side, because there's projects that we may not be aware of that are on the horizon that you all are thinking.
Mm-hmm. Well, again, the financial plan that we're putting forward is only for that corridor. It's not going to deal with I-19. It's not going to deal with the Sonoran corridor. No, those are also high priorities for the region, but they're not, you know, necessarily mentioned. So that funding is all going to be allocated toward those projects as well.
I understand. All I'm suggesting is maybe we throw it all together into a pot and take a look at it. And again, as opposed to the piecemeal approach, it's just more holistic. And it could be that at the end, the 90 million stays here, the 290 million stay in this plan. I'm just throwing that out.
So
good. Oh, I'm sorry. Go
ahead. I have one more question then. I guess it would be for Farhad. Wouldn't that be one of the aspects of the RMAP?
Correct. So the RMAP is a long range plan. Obviously, that has a 25-year horizon. It is fiscally constrained. So as part of that exercise, you can look at projects that are in the RMAP plan with that fiscal constraint and make an assumption that it will be funded somehow. The only challenge is that RMAP doesn't get to that level of identifying what funding source is used on what project. And that's really what we're talking about here today, right, to get to that level of detail.
Right. So I think there's also other components. You can only get, I'm not confident that you can rely 20 years out on that funding. Things happen. Recessions occur. Great, you know, financial calamities occur. Legislative bodies come in and move funding around. That'll all happen in that time frame. So we can come up with the best laid plan, but the reality is it might not follow out that way.
I think you're talking to a whole group that's been struggling with the old six RTA deliveries. So I think we're clear. Go ahead, John.
Yes, thanks, Mr. Chairman. I guess my question is, are we saying that the current transportation improvement program has no mention of either the Cortero or the Tetrine TIs? Are those projects that far in the future?
So, yes, they are not mentioned in our current TIP. Current TIP is actually ADOT programs, a 5-year TIP. The PAG region programs are 2 or...
So it's a 5-year TIP as well.
It's a 5-year TIP as well. And neither of those projects are in the current program.
Gotcha. So thanks.
To add to that, obviously, if the RTA passes and if there's new funding coming to the region, then the TIP can be amended to include any new funding and any new projects.
Well, I guess the related question is, are there any ADOT projects in the current TIP?
Yes.
Yes.
And are they included in anything we're discussing on RTA? Next.
No, not on this list. On this list, there are 5 projects that are in the ADOT right away, and none of them are currently in the TIP.
Gotcha.
I'm sorry, I take that back.
Well,
portion of SR 210.
Well, the RTA next starts in 27. If it were brought by the voters, so it's in the out years of the TIP. So it's starting the most tenuous time of the TIP anyway, where we change things off as those years progress. But right now, the only projects that ADOT has in the 5-year TIPs, even out of that design concept report, we have the first 4 projects are programmed in the TIP. Originally, we had one of those projects in RTA next as a proposed project, but it didn't advance, and that was the South 6th Bridge.
But I think what we've been saying most of this discussion is we may want to take an overall new look at least the 5-year TIP when we've got this list of projects in front of us to say, should we modify the TIP in the whole scale, a wholesale right now because we've changed our mind?
I think, John, that's exactly the conversation is how we approach this knowing that we've got a shortfall, right? We've got a shortfall, or at least we've got a delta to make up in the RTA plan. So how do we scrounge and scrape local funding, other sources of funding to accomplish this, but do it in the context of the priorities of the region? And so if the priority of the region is different than what you're proposing, well, then that's the conversation with the
Just want to clarify, John, for obviously to respond to you and everybody else's benefit, the TIP cannot assume there is going to be funding. There has to be a guarantee of funding before the TIP can be updated. So that's why you really need the plan to be approved first before you go back and amend anything in the TIP. Otherwise, we can't assume there's any potential new RTA money.
But does that apply to any ADOT funding?
Again, currently we are only up until 2026, and in the current TIP, we do not have any of these projects, correct?
Correct.
Correct.
Okay.
And all the current RTA funding on ADOT projects is allocated and moving forward?
They're all already allocated, committed, yep.
Good, Carmen.
So maybe a little bit of an explanation of how the ADOT projects make their way into the TIP, because what I see is a jurisdiction who has as their number one and number two priority two projects that aren't reflected. So there's a process for that. And what is the jurisdictional role in that process, or is it currently decided at a level that doesn't include the jurisdictions, right? So we've talked before about having subcommittee structures and having them weigh in on these items through their representatives who are the jurisdictional directors of our departments of transportation. So what is the role of the jurisdictions in that process of coming up with the prioritized list of ADOT projects that make it into the TIP?
Sure,
and then Rod, feel free to chime in. So the process currently is that ADOT will submit a proposed list of projects. They prioritize, look at the program, they submit a proposed list of priorities. This is all within ADOT right-of-way facilities. The funds are allocated for ADOT facilities. So they develop the proposal, submit the proposal, and it goes through our committee process and recommendations to fund those projects. It goes through TIP, TPC, regional council, management, regional council. That's the current process.
So the opportunity for input is at each one of those levels of the meetings.
Correct.
That's where the opportunity for input from all of the jurisdictions takes place. And if there is an issue with it, it's discussed. I've never really had too many issues come up, and there's never really been any pushback in terms of what ADOT's desire, but that's the opportunity that would happen.
I'm just and still wondering how there's a seeming misalignment.
I will go on a limb here because I've been on the ADOT side as well and watched this, and I think that when ADOT brings forth their plan, they're based on operational state highway operational issues or constraints or priorities. And we obviously bring different perspectives. And it's not that they do it on their own, but when we're sitting around looking at the TIP that's already kind of baked based on recommendations from the resident experts, we're not necessarily thinking about what impact it has on us directly, or what impact or what feedback we could provide that. And just in fairness to all. However, given this conversation, and I'm not saying anybody ain't wrong or underhanded, I think it's just traditionally the way it's been. Given this conversation, though, I think there is an opportunity for us to challenge the TIP development going forward. So we get the recommendations from ADOT as a group. We input our thoughts and we look at, from a priority standpoint, from a regional priority standpoint, to provide that feedback, as opposed to, yeah, those are the needs and we're good and we rubber stamp it and moves on. So I do think that there's opportunity moving forward as
now this knowledge that we have to have conversations about how do we deliver some of these projects. It's my gut.
Good, right? And is there time within the current TIF process to incorporate that?
I don't know about the current TIF. I don't know where we are.
It's been already gone through the TIF process. TIF committee made a recommendation to include ADOT projects in the upcoming 5-year plan.
When is that?
How far into that 5-year TIF?
Yeah.
It's only 5 years. So it goes 27, 28 are the two new years into the new 5-year plan. So it's only up to 28.
But where exactly is the TIP development process today, right now? Where is it?
TIP subcommittee made a recommendation to move forward with ADOT projects. That's the step right now.
Where does it go next?
Then it goes to TPC and then management and then regional council.
So when is it scheduled?
For what? Scheduled for what? TPC, when is the next TPC?
Next Wednesday.
Yeah.
Okay. And then it'll come to TMC.
Yes.
Yeah. Management.
Those are the opportunities for input.
That's on the PAC side. Yeah,
no,
So I would like to make a couple of clarifications. I'm not confident there is a misunderstanding. I think there's a time frame. So the TIP that is moving through the process right now is a 5-year TIP. So it goes from 24 to 28. Actually, no, we haven't even moved that one from. We're modifying the 23 TIP. So it goes from 23 to 27. So we're not doing a new TIP. We're modifying the existing TIP, okay? So from 23 to 27. If the RTA Next program, if everything went well, lined out perfectly, we were looking at starting that program in 27 is the theory. So that would be the final year of the existing TIP. So we're really, the timing is such that any projects that are currently in the RTA Next plan are really not timed as such to come forward in the existing TIP yet. They are moved in the RMAP system. That's why I asked Farhad about the RMAP, because that's where you're going to see them. And that's where you're going to make a determination of the feasibility of what period of the RTA Next that they will be done in. And that's when you're going to start looking at if there's a DCR for this project, or do we need to do a DCR? And that will take X number of years. So we'll have to go out and do this project. So the TIP is a living document that gets updated in every year for 5 years. So you got a 5-year segment, then you got another 5-year segment, then another 5-year segment. That's how that whole thing works. So next year, we'll start entering the next, or the theoretical first year of RTA Next in the TIP development process. Have I muddied it up too much?
No, that's fine. I don't think anyone's arguing that. I think it's really bringing forth the opportunity that, you know, because quite frankly, I had never even thought about the TIP development or the ADOT recommendation as factoring into the RTA Next discussion, other than the three projects. And then as I started thinking that it's another pot of money that's available to the region, we should throw it onto the table and say, okay, how does that work to try to solve the region's problems, one component of which are within the ADOT right of way? That's all I'm saying. And I think that we should explore that. You make me nervous when you say you're only looking to the 28, because we got to look at the 20 years.
Mm-hmm.
And so a worst case scenario would be that, you know, pick one of these projects, you know, it's Terry's number one, and we put it into the, you know, the local component is $20 million and the allocation is $70 million, and something happens and we can't fund it. Now what? You know, for whatever reason, that goes haywire, right? That would be a bigger concern. And that's why I think, back to Carmine's point, a long range plan of what those scenarios could look like is going to be extremely important. And that's going to push some of your folks out of their comfort zone, because they're used to thinking in 5-year chunks. But I think we've got to look at a little longer in terms of what we can then go to the voter and say, hey, this is a good thing.
And I think that's a role for both PAG and ADOT staff to come together. It's not strictly, and ADOT will say, well, this is our projected funding. How that gets done is a regional component.
I agree. And I would also say that the development of that is iterative on an annual basis, but for the RTA commitments. I mean, voters approved and we're done, we're cooked. We got to deliver that. But there's all these other, we'll call them dials, that we can turn down the road. And that's what we got to make sure we're clear on it front. Other thoughts or comments? It's a good discussion. I appreciate it. Thank you, Rod and Farhad. Appreciate the education. I think that opens up some doors that maybe didn't think about it before. So our next meeting, go ahead, Tom.
Just to put a bow on it, what might be helpful would be to do some scenario planning. Take a look at different ways of sharing that money. In other words, different matches and what they may result in as far as the RTA next budget, as well as what might lose its way in the current PAG region step or priorities. But in some way to, as Carmine was saying, add some dollars to this so you can say, if you had 10% match for all of the ADOT projects, this is what would happen to the rest of the ADOT program. If you had a 50%, here's what that would mean to the RTA next list, because at some point we need to go into the process of removing projects. And one thing we didn't talk about today is the fact that not all of these cost estimates have, in fact, I'm not sure any of them really do, have inflation factors or recent cost inflation added to them. And as I told the CAC recently, or multiple times, we're likely going to have to remove projects once we get those cost estimates back, because it's impossible for things that originated in 2019 to be very accurate today.
Just to clarify, these are the most recent updated costs we have, and that's why it's increased.
These are from the jurisdiction.
Yeah, jurisdictions have updated their costs, but you're correct. It's a moving target. It'll move again.
I think I've brought that up a few times, not only in terms of not having the expertise. I mean, I appreciate everybody's efforts. I mean, we did the same thing, go back and do the best you can. But I've also advocated for hiring a consultant come in and really dissect that and hone in on that. But I do think that your point about the cost, the escalation of costs over time, both from inflation as well as other factors, is extremely important. And I think that's what painted us in a corner on the 2006. So other thoughts or comments? You know, Bob brought up a couple of points, 36 and Country Club. What I would suggest is that maybe we come back and have a discussion around those at our next meeting. I think that's gives everybody a chance to dissect the conversation, think about the tip, think about local match, give Rod a chance to regroup. but I think that this was a really healthy discussion on how we accomplish the ultimate goal, which is coming up with a plan that will resonate with the voter. I see that, Curtis, you have your hand up.
Now, this is a quickie, Mike. Just a question on the cost estimating procedure. Does PAG follow the FHWA guidance or the RTA, and do the local jurisdictions? And I guess what I'm getting at is that the cost estimates be prepared in a consistent manner. Mike has talked about retaining a consultant to do some cost estimate updates. I would suggest that we consider adopting the FHWA guidance on cost estimating, because it's fairly comprehensive, which I think we need to be more careful with the RTA next estimating than we were originally in 2006. We need to be more detailed, follow FHWA, and all of the jurisdictions need to be consistent. So in 2006, RTA retained the consultants that updated all the estimates. I think it was URS. And it was like a 1 or 2% level of detail on it. But I think we just need to, again, just to need to be somewhat detailed and consistent across the region on these estimates. So thank you.
All right, I think you, that was your plan, right?
We have a consultant on board and they're ready to go. And obviously they're anxious and waiting until we get to a list that they can start working on it. They're doing all the background work on the current list. They're ready to go. Really, the conversation becomes, how close are we to a final list? And I think we're almost there.
Yeah, are there, what about their consistency? Does their work have them doing the FHWA process?
Rick, do you know, maybe Rick can answer that question.
I'm not familiar with the FHWA process.
Works. Okay, there we go. So the approach and methodology we've talked about is to essentially do a 3D visualization. They have the capabilities with their graphics and their design software to actually lay out what the design would look like. So we're going to use that as the basis. It'll still be a bottoms-up calculated type of approach, but we're going to apply a boatload of lessons learned out of there. Contingencies that were just generally assumed, we'll be using a more strategic approach. So some projects are further along in design, have a more concrete piece of information, we'll use less contingency. Others may have a lot more complications, we'll use a higher amount. We'll have to use different approaches because the SR210 projects have DCR development. The design's fairly well fleshed out. Others are a line item concept on a piece of paper. So we are going to be consistent in our methodologies and approach, but there will be variations depending on the uniqueness of each project and how we have to strategically tackle it. So Curtis, I don't know if that answers your question, but we've got a very holistic, detailed, and thorough approach that we're going to be working on, and it's going to be hand in hand with the jurisdictions. All the lessons learned that worked for us the last time, we're going to be incorporating that and meeting with the individual departments to make sure scope features, identified elements, assumptions are captured, documented, and incorporated appropriately.
Yeah, that's very encouraging, Rick. I will, I'll email you when our meeting is completed, the FHWA guidance. And I think you're fairly close to it. So thank you for that.
I was going to say, shoot that over. Then I can compare that up against what we've got and align with those to make sure it's on the same track.
Right on. Thanks.
You got it.
Rick, while you're at the podium there, are we looking at when these projects might be delivered in the 20-year plan? Some of those inflation assumptions would change if they're on the first 5 years versus the last 5 years. How is that being factored into the cost estimates?
So those will be afterwards to know that we've got a dash. Take any kind of modifier or inflationary factor on that. So we'll look at them all current, latest, and greatest, recognizing the volatility of the market. So we know we're in that situation and we'll have an even baseline and then we'll know how we'll be able to adjust that and age that out over the course of the plan. So we are going to try to look at them in the most current updated mindset. And with a lot of luck, we'll have better data points on more recent projects that we can utilize for some of those values that have been conveyed, talked to us, and the industry has shared.
Yeah. Let me get back to the FHWA guidance for just a second. What it does is it looks at the proposed project implementation dates and inflates the estimates into those year dollars and so on. And so it tends to look at things in a scheduled basis, which I think is much more helpful. So anyhow, I'll Farhad and Mike, I'll send that FHWA guidance to both of you as well as a city and to Rick. And I hope you find it helpful because to me, it's really the pristine way to go. So thank you.
Thanks, Curtis. And I think the big thing, and I think Farhad reinforced it, is a consistent approach. We use one consultant to do that, the consistency, but the FHWA guidance may be I suspect that's what ADOT uses for their approach. So yeah, if you could send that, Curtis, that could be helpful. Thanks, Rick. Appreciate it. Anything else for the good of the order on that? I think this was a good conversation, probably one of the better ones in terms of maybe trying to figure out how to get to the end game. We have a meeting on March 8th, which will be in anticipation or preparation for the March 23rd tentative meeting date of the RTA board. That's the email I saw yesterday. Is there anything else on that topic? Jan is gone, so we'll assume she has nothing. And we will be going down. Future agenda items for the group to consider down the road.
Mike, will we get a report back from the CAC on the discussion relative to the categorical elements and the transit subcommittee that's meeting next week? I think there'd be value in the spirit of a holistic approach to this, getting a report.
I assume that's not a problem.
No, certainly. I think it'd just be wrapped up in the CAC report that you'll have at your next meeting.
By the way, Tom, I appreciate you being here. I know Carolyn's on the phone as well. I think it's really helpful to have you all at the table with us. Thank you for being there. Very much appreciate it. All right. If there's nothing else for the good of the order, up, Curtis, again, go for it.
Thank you. I want to tear off of what Shane almost made as a motion earlier, and that was for the TMC to look at some of the jurisdictional or local funding options. And if that was almost a motion, I will almost second it.
So here's my suggestion. You're talking about increasing the half-cent sales tax to something greater than that, three-quarter or 1 cent.
Yeah, impact fees, exactions, several options that are out there. I know the RTA has already a couple of documents, but I think we could look at the TMC, the non-jurisdictional members, could look at it in a little bit more detail and provide some insight to the TMC and potentially the board.
Okay, so I think the homework assignment is to go back and take a look at the cost again, the projects again, make sure that we're all good with it, but also look at the potential for jurisdictional funding that we can bring to the game. And I think that's the conversation that we had. And that could be impact fees or other, and we'll come back with that. That's going to be a tall order, is my gut, but I mean, I think it's worth the exercise to at least think about it and put it out there. And it may be that our councils don't have, or board don't have, meetings where they can give us specific direction, but at least we can throw some things on the table as to what the thought process is. Because I think back to Terry's point, we're going to meet before his council does. So that is on the table. What I thought you were referring to is the potential of an increase in the sales tax. So I'd like to delay that conversation until another time, because I think let's stay focused on the parameters that we've got for now. And then as time goes on, we can have a discussion about, maybe a recommendation that might expand it. Just my gut at this point.
Yeah, I agree with you, Mike, on the on options for the sales tax amount. That's a hot potato right now, and that's best left to the RTA board and executive director to deal with.
Okay, and we can weigh in on that when appropriate. But right now, I think we'll try to get the lists plural accomplished. Go ahead, Bill. I see your hand up.
Thanks, Chairman. This is obviously a really simple process to move this forward based on the discussion we had today, but you said the homework assignment is to go back CAC, TMC, and look at the different projects and which ones are the ones that, are we in agreement that these are the right projects? The one question I'm not really understanding is, are you asking us in that process to cut back to the 1.1 number and eliminate some projects, or are you just asking whether or not we believe all of these projects are important and necessary?
That's a great question, Bill. I think it's all of the above. I can tell you, and I've outlined for you the approach that I'm going to be looking at or taking is, our Move Tucson effort and how that works in a holistic manner. One component of it is the name projects, and then I'll come back with some thoughts on that. But I think the expectation, the assignment is, how do we get, everybody needs an opportunity to weigh in. And the current apparent shortfall is, $350 million. So what does that look like? And how do we potentially start paring those down? Bob brought up a couple of projects, so that could be a starting point as well. So I think it's just continuing the dialogue about what's on the list, but also what other funding sources might be able to be brought to the game to help put it together, Bill.
Thanks, Mike. And this ties into what Kurt was just asking. It's kind of like the chicken or the egg. If we find some local funding sources that allow us to get up to the higher number, then there's no issues. But if we don't know what those potential funding dollars are, then we start saying, okay, we're going to crop something off the list. And it's important for us to be aware of the fact that if one community is putting in money, we don't want to chop their projects because then that money goes away. And so I mean, there's we can look at it in the meantime, but I think getting some funding source, local funding source, at least some estimate of what it is and where it would come from, allows us to be able to look at it better. Thanks.
No, I hear you. And I think that's all part of the evolution. So I think we'll keep muddling our way through this and we're going to get to a good spot. Anything else for the good of the order?
Mike.
Yep.
The next meeting, is it both a PAG management?
Yeah, that's what you said, I think, was it is a PAG management
typically meeting. Typically, we have the management committee meeting followed by the TMC meeting.
Okay. So typically, we'll see if that happens or not. Okay. We're atypical these days. All right. If there's nothing else for the good of the order, we can adjourn. Thank you very much.
Thank you.